You're listening to the Ask Drone You podcast. You ask, we answer your drone questions. Whether you're here to turn your passion into profit or you simply fly for fun, we're a community of learners and teachers who aspire to achieve greatness. We are
Drone You.
Hey everyone, welcome to another awesome episode of Ask Drone You. My name is Paul, and today I have the pleasure of having Patrick Egan from sUAS News here on the show today. Pat, thanks so much for coming on the show.
Hey, thanks for having me.
It's funny, I was on your show, what was it, 2 or 3 years ago now, and it really did a lot for us, but I wanted to bring Pat on the show today for you guys, because he's really going to give us an idea of where the drone industry is for 2017, what to expect, what's necessary to see growth, but also, how is the Drone Advisory Committee? If you remember, that's the committee from the FAA that's supposed to be helping out guys like us, the small business owners in the drone world, but as many of you know, that's not really the case. So, here to give us the update, Pat, I'm so excited to hear what happened up in Reno. I mean, there's so much to talk about, and everything I've heard from you so far is not that exciting.
Well, you know, you talked about, you know, first I want to talk about the lack of representation for the, say, commercial, small business, guy trying to make jobs, guy, gal. And if I say guy, we just got to assume that I'm talking about, you know, the fairer sex too, but you know, that's a drag because we're not being represented. You know, I was talking to some other people that are old guard integration effort people about the DAC thing, and they just snickered and laughed at my report because basically, you know, I have a lot of experience. I worked with the RTCA back in 2006, ASTM 2005, and now what's happening is I'm the guy that's got, let's say, more, I don't want to say experience because I haven't been at the process that long, but I started the process before the FAA reps, before the guy who's actually the head of the 228. So that's how far back my participation goes. And I'm going to say that I'm not really, I'm a little dismayed that we're kind of at the same place with the same assumptions, with the lack of data.
Well, you say the lack of data, that's an argument the FAA made, what was it, 2 years ago when they said we're not ready for 107, we don't have enough quote-unquote data, but albeit there was lots of data.
Well, when this whole thing started, you know, the FAA had this cute bumper sticker, you know, do no harm, you know. Oh, okay. Well, do we know have we defined the risk, what the risk is to the NAS? No. So how do we know what kind of harm we're going to do to the NAS? Oh, well, we don't know. I'm just going to say this. You know, people tried to tell me, because I'm like, wow, this is kind of disappointing. We're like at square one. This is what I've been hearing for 12 years, you know? Oh, no, it's different because the technology changed. And I'm like, the technology changed? What? I mean, we're still talking about integrating aircraft into the national airspace system, right?
That's right.
Well, that's not really what they got there. You have half of the people are like, we're integrating the internet into the NAS. Yeah, it just doesn't make any sense. And then, you know, this thing's supposed to be a 12-month to 24-month interim thing. And, you know, you have people, you know, from some of the bigger, you know, let's say internet names. Oh, you know, don't call it spectrum. It's not spectrum. It's communication. And we're going to have light communication and it's going to, you know, control it. So it won't be. And I'm thinking to myself, it sounds like a Silicon Valley snow job where we have some technology that's out there 10 years from now that we're talking about as a solution for today. That's not very realistic. I think that the FAA needs to bring the conversation back around and say, hey, well, this is aviation. We're talking about aircraft. We're talking about the NAS. We're not talking about cell phone apps or something else. And so I'm a little, I was a little taken aback on that. Now, the other thing is I did, take pictures of the slides and I did Periscope it. So the public meeting, okay. Now for years, I've been talking about the private-public process. So I did do some video before so people could get a little flavor of what the committee is like. After lunch, you know, they got up and they said, well, no video. of the public meeting, which I think, you know, that turns the
No video
of the public meeting. That turns the stakeholder into a bag holder, in my estimation, because not everyone can go. I took 2 days off to go up there and sit around at the meeting and chew the fat and all the rest of that. And even before we went live here, we talked about, you know, some of the other issues that, you know, it takes time out of my schedule. I'm trying to do the expo. I got all kinds of stuff going.
Let me ask you this. So they weren't very transparent. They weren't very public. What were the issues that they were even discussing? Because like you said, you've been seeing the same thing 12 years in a row, and that's really kind of disappointing to hear that we're still seeing that today. But what did they talk about? Why are they trying to be so secretive and not allow video during a public hearing? Which, by the way, I'm pretty sure that breaks the law if they say it's a public hearing.
You know, that'll get you labeled a hothead, okay? You know, I've been saying all along, even when I was on the ARC, okay, this is a public rulemaking. Can't talk about it. I'm like, you better trot out Title V of the United States Code and show me where it says that I can't talk about public rulemaking and laws, because I don't know of that. That doesn't, you know, that's not the country. The civics class I sat in was a little different. However, I had a big blowout with ASTM too, because it was going to be a deal when you know, they were going to use standards with the 107 came out. You'd have to pay $75 read the standards. Man, I blew a gasket on that one, because I didn't think that was fair. I got to pay $75 to see what the law of the land is going to be. That's not right. Anyway, that policy has been changed, but it's an ongoing thing. And I don't think that it's so much that, like, you know, it's secret, because it's a public meeting. But I will say that anyone who has any degree of experience is going to say, wow, you got a committee here with 40 plus people on it with some big issues. You're not going to get anything done here in this aggressive timeline. It's just not happening. When I was on RTCA, I think we had, like, you know, 10, 15 people on the whole committee, maybe 20. And there were some subcommittees. You know, you didn't like something. Hey, Joe, Bub, let's go have dinner. We'll talk it over. We'll work it out. Okay. You can't do that with 40 people. It's just not happening. And then all the other support people around that. So I think that there might be a little bit of, let's say, hesitation to share with the community a process that may not be producing what people think it's going to produce. Now, the big issues. Everybody, oh, beyond visual line of sight next week. Oh, we're going for it. Going to be flying beyond visual line of sight. You know, there were people telling people that some of this beyond visual line of sight stuff was a chance that it was going to be in 107. Total misrepresentation of the facts. Never going to be part of 107. There's no data. You know, I met the guy who, for the RTCA committee, is going to head up the detect and avoid, which, you know, I've been beating this drum like I was in the marching band for years. We talk about detect and avoid. What is the baseline? Where's the baseline for detect and avoid that you're working from? And that still hasn't been established.
So BVLOS, they're talking about sense and avoid, so ADS-B or TCAS type systems.
Well, the problem with ADS-B, there's two big problems. And anyone, you know, you see these stories, oh, ADS-B, you know, okay, well, you got, it's great, you know, they came and let the air out of my balloon during the ARC on ADS-B. Two different freaks. You know, there's the 121 guys are squawking one freak. The GA guys are squawking another freak. You need in and out on both. The mandate doesn't cover all aircraft in the different airspaces. That's one problem. Two, the system would be overwhelmed if drones were on it. Three, the FAA has no plan to support a public algorithm for detect and avoid.
Gotcha. So let's just knock that off then. So ADS-B is not a good idea, and I know people have talked about TCAS. Are are they talking about releasing a new law with these allowances? Because I know flying over people was supposed to be a big deal too.
Yeah, that they got a little pushback on that. Now, what you're going to see is you're definitely going to see, and I already saw one article where it's like the Trump administration, and we don't know what's going on here, and oh, the whole, you know, the whole thing's going to get, the wheels are coming off the apple cart. And that's not really true. The wheels were coming off the apple cart before, you know, the new administration had stepped in, which is, it's a normal stuff. Every time there's a new presidential administration, you get, hey, wait a minute, that might be, look at this. But the flying over people, there was pushback from stakeholder groups. They said no. And the OEMs, you know, is another drum I've been beating is the OEMs need to get together and do...
The manufacturers you're talking about, right? So everyone understands?
Yes, exactly. OEM, the original. Okay, anyway, so the thing with that is they haven't done any research, so they can't go in and go, oh, well, you know, Congressman Bag of Donuts, I've got the data right here. We've done the, and you know, we had a third party, couple of universities check it out, MIT, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. And you know, we'd like you to see this. They don't have any of that.
Well, that's surprising because Virginia Tech just did some testing with phantoms hitting people in the head, which, you know, great. Yeah, this is so funny because all this testing to me can only be limited by the knowledge of the operator. And when I watch these tests by Virginia Tech, when I watch these tests by MIT, they're all done in the same circumstances. They're all done with new pilots flying in GPS with default gains. And it's like, you know what, guys, if you really want to see how powerful a drone is and whether it can hurt people, what we need to do is really test the maximum. So why don't you put this thing in manual mode or attitude mode? Let's throw an Inspire up there at full speed with a tailwind and see what it's going to do to someone's head.
Well, you know, what you're doing is aptly illustrating what the problem is with, let's say, non-drone people doing the research, which I've always been against. And the reason that is because, you know, they don't know the questions to ask. And you know, don't think that I haven't tried to get the OEMs to pay for research. You know, and I always tell people I'd love to claim the credit for this research matrix that I've been trying to champion for all these years. But actually, it was a group of engineers from this federal, you know, administration called NASA. Came up with a test matrix. And so I even did bring it to the manufacturers and said, hey, you know, anywhere between $100,000 and $250,000, we could start doing some research. And I'm not into junk science. My thing was, if I'm going to be a part of it, I'm just a sniff test guy. We're going to have to hire an independent investigator. You're going to come in. We're going to do the test. It's going to be totally objective. And we're going to put it out there. And the way the data is going to be is, please come and disprove our findings. That's the only way it's going to work. Then you go in there, and when they try and shut you down for flying over people or whatever, you can come in and go, well, you know, our data shows something different, you know, blah, blah, blah. But now you go in and you tell people your feelings, you know, and I have a little joke about that, but I'm like, really, nobody gives a rat's nest about your feelings except on Valentine's Day, which is coming up.
Hey, you know, maybe so. That made them feel special.
Exactly. Oh, that's great. I feel loved. So anyway, you know, that aside, so, you know, the funny thing is I am going to, I got to grab a screen grab of the dummy, the Virginia Tech dummy sitting there, because I think, I thought I recognized him from some of the advocacy efforts as the guy running the show. We need to be asking the questions. We are the drone people. We understand the applications. That has always been missing. And one of the things that's missing, and it goes back to the beginning of this conversation when we were talking about end user, commercial end user representation. And people go, oh, AUVSI. Oh, yeah.
No, AUVSI, for all of you guys that are listening, in fact, Pat and I have talked about this for a long time, is pretty much run by Boeing and what's the other name? Lockheed Martin.
Yeah, and essentially, those guys checked out. They checked out because it's a dog and pony show. I mean, the membership, they're losing members like it's going out of style. And they're the money is like they're hemorrhaging money and they can't figure it out.
Well, when you're spending hundreds of thousands of dollars at CES to have Drone Zone presented by AUVSI and no one even looks at it because everyone knows they're a joke.
Well, the bonuses, the salaries, you know, that really, I mean, I was the Silicon Valley chapter president for 3 years and it didn't end well. You know, it wasn't even my idea to become the chapter president. When I took it over, it was like, you know, five guys sitting around doing the Roberts rules, deciding if we were going to have pepperoni or Hawaiian pizza.
And all right, let's get back to the DAC. Okay, so did you hear, let me ask you this, since we've been talking for some time about everything that's gone wrong, did you see anything that gave you hope for representation of the small guys or new rules or anything positive?
Well, you know, a lot of people say I'm negative, and then they've added mean to the description. But no, I'm not encouraged. I've got to be honest. You know, a couple of issues. One, co-chair, the lady that used to work for 3D Robotics. I think she made some big mistakes during the registration task force. Now, you know, and I talk to a lot of people globally. Okay. And I'm going to go back to the registration task force last year. Most of the manufacturers and the people that sell retail drones have said sales are off since then. Okay. I don't understand. I mean, even 3D Robotics.
Sales are off since the registration?
Since the registration. And even 3D Robotics was counting on a big Christmas last year to save their bacon, and the whole deal went down the tubes.
3DR so, was done before Christmas even happened, let's be honest.
Well, yeah, but I mean, that was the Hail Mary play. We were waiting for that last year, and it just didn't pan out. But anyway, the whole registration debacle was all predicated on a report from MITRE, which was, based on a Ministry of Defense report that, you know, the 250 grams was shrapnel from an explosion and that could be fatal. And I asked Nancy Egan, I said, hey, I don't know, you know, they liken your products to shrapnel from explosions. Is that what you guys are selling over there?
Yeah.
Well, nothing. You know, you should have got up and left. And I told Chilman the same deal. I said, hey, man, you know, I wouldn't have sat there and let them destroy my industry on some data or report that has nothing to do with what I'm doing. I don't do anything with bombs and shrapnel and explosions. That's not my bag, man. I fly the drone. But that goes right back to not having any data from the industry side to say, well, you know, that's cute and fuzzy and the bomb thing is great, but that has no bearing on what we're talking about here. But on the this does. This is research we did. So here, why don't you check this out? And then you can get back to me and we'll talk about registration at a later date when it makes sense and you have something that's relevant to what we're talking about. Instead, everybody sold everybody down the river. They didn't understand what was going on. And the other deal is that I didn't like about that is the AMA tried to put in a dissenting opinion into the consensus of the registration arc, and they were not supported by the other people that are supposedly advocating for, you know, this community. So when you think you got your heroes out there advocating for us, I don't know what they're doing. They're building up their Twitter following. They're trying to make a name for themselves. Now, you know, back to the DAC with Nancy, I'm not sure what I consult to them means. So she asked me that suggested that I should ask 3D Robotics what her official position was or affiliation was with 3D Robotics. And I said I would, and I'd probably do that publicly on Twitter, but I doubt that that I would get a response. And she seemed to indicate that was probably because I was mean. You know, and I said, well, is it mean or is it somebody has a bruised ego because they, you know, gross mismanagement lost $100 million?
Yeah.
I don't know. And if you can't take it, then maybe you shouldn't be in the public light, you know, proselytizing all of this. Not for me to determine. All I know is I report the news. I didn't lose the $100 million. But anyway, I don't think that she's qualified.
So, long story short, nothing positive.
Well, no, I think we're asking some good questions. I think some of the new questions are good. And that was one of the, they had an economist from the, or an accountant from the FAA came out and talked about the budget in the FAA. And people are wondering, how are we going to pay for all of the infrastructure for drones? Fair question, right?
Yeah. What about all the money from registration is what I've been asking.
Yeah, you know, the registration, the $5 for registration, you know, for a federal agency, they're probably losing money on that. Mm. You know, my estimate, if you're paying $5, it probably costs them $8 or $9 to get it done. You know, that's kind of how it works. So there's not a big pot of money there. What's probably going on is, you know, usually they have user fees, you know, like when you go buy a commercial airline ticket, there's fees on that, and that pays for air traffic control and infrastructure and all the rest of that. Same thing for the GA guys, they pay, blah, blah, blah. There's fuel taxes, yada, yada. And then the money goes into the kitty, and then the Congress allocates it for different things. But all I got to say, so they're like, well, is it an excise tax? Because, you know, we don't really use fuel. You know, what's it going to be? Whatever. I mean, I'm not an economist. Somebody brought that up. Are there any economists in the room? One guy raised his hand, and then the other guy from the AEVSI said he was a recovering economist, which I find surprising with their forecast, but, you know, whatever, stranger things. 16,000 Part 107 certificates carry the two plus several hundred million dollars. I don't think that's going to work. I don't know if they're going to come up with the money. So, well, what they need to do is, and I tweeted that out, is get better lobbyists. I think the cheap money has been spent in the lobby department. You're going to have to go in there, and you're going to have to get Congress to appropriate money for the infrastructure. This isn't going to be a build-as-you-go thing. It's not going to be like, well, you know what we'll do is we'll get, $10 and we'll put up a windsock, and then 10 years from now we'll worry about all the radar and the, you know, whatever else. It just doesn't work that way. I think what it is there's a problem that goes back to the committee. It's very diverse. Lots of people on it, but there are a lot of people that shouldn't really have no business of being on it. And I don't see it getting done. The other thing I think they need to do is, like I said before, kind of the FAA needs to bring it around and say, hey, this is aviation again. It's not, you know, cell phone apps or whatever. And, you know, they got to decide too. You know, people are talking, oh, you know, cell phones for command and control and cell phones for air traffic control and things like that. I just don't think that's realistic. They're just not very reliable.
Gotcha. All right, let's move on from DAC, because that seems like it is a nightmare. There are no real positive outcomes where the little guys are not being...
I don't want to sound all doom and gloom. I do think that, you know, we're highlighting the issues again. And here's the NREN, okay? I think people are going to take from that that's kind of a slow process, whatever else. The smart money is on Congress. The smart money is going to have people, and I do think that the science thing is important. Smart money is going to be, we're going to have to talk to Congress, have them appropriate some money, have them do things, you know, lay out some goals for the FAA and take money away, yada, yada, yada. That's how government works, not, you know, may I please and blah, blah, blah. So I do think that that's the silver lining. People are going to understand these are the issues, 5, 10, whatever they are. We need to go to Congress and we need action from Congress. So that's the silver line.
Gotcha. All right. Well, let's move on to other things in this industry. And 2017 should be an interesting year. So with all of this going on, do you think that the drone industry is going to grow? If so, what do you think is necessary for the industry to grow this year?
For me, last year was the year of intellectual honesty in the drone sphere. And that, really ruffled people's feathers in the wrong way. I mean, people were really upset about that. But I think it's a lot of it's kind of come around, and the things that I was saying gonna happen. So now we're in a, you know, I don't know if you followed any of that, but when the 107 came out, I said, really now it is up to the droners to put up or shut up. Because now you have a legal way to operate. Well, you know, people were like, well, it's too restrictive and I can't make money. Hey, look, everybody was out doing anything they wanted to do. There were few people that had, you know, airmen certificates probably weren't doing that because they didn't want to get their tickets taken. But most of the success stories were out there doing everything they wanted to do beyond visual line of sight, at night, whatever they wanted to do. So it was almost because there were no rules, you could do whatever you wanted to do. And people couldn't make it work then. Okay, so now we came out. I mean, I thought it was kind of telling that during the same, you know, within a week's time of 107 came out, you know, the news came out that 3D Robotics was going out of business as a drone company. I mean, that's weird, you know. I thought it was strange, ironic. But really, the first thing for me was when Trimble said, we're out of the drone thing. That told me, Trimble's a huge company, billions of dollars. They have a great reputation. They know their business. They do it well, world leader recognized. And they were like, you know what? We'll let somebody else do that. That told me that there were issues with the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. So, you know, those are the things. This like, hey, we're going to be delivering. I just don't see burrito delivery as being a viable, you know, use. The other thing I think we're going to see.
Hey, here in New Mexico, burrito delivery could actually be pretty viable.
I like a nice burrito like the next guy, you know, but I mean, you know, I could just go downstairs.
I think it would have to be a pretty burrito centric place.
Yeah, you know, what was that, the burrito in Albuquerque? That's a commercial. But, you know, like the delivery thing, you know, like we've talked about flying over people. If you're going to fly over people and you have failures, you're going to get sued.
Yep.
You know, we have.
Hold on. You bring a good point. Would you say, maybe this is something for people to pick up on, would you say that this industry is not actually controlled by the FAA, but is rather going to be controlled by this litigious society?
Well, I think you're going to have a little of both. You know, but if you have, let's just say you have the stapler internet company, and they deliver everything by drone, staplers, staple removers, whatever. And they have, you know, 100,000 drones in the air every day. And there's an attrition rate. It's 1%, 2% of the drones falling out of the sky and hitting people. People aren't going to tolerate that. And they're already, you know, that's another dark horse or sleeper.
Is the fact that there are already lawsuits now against drones? I'm hoping you were going to go into that.
Yeah, there already are. It's just not really talked about. But product liability lawsuits. Kind of funny. We got a lawyer who's coming to speak at the expo. And, you know, I asked her. I said, hey, you know, we talked about, and she does legal work for some of the bigger drone companies out of Silicon Valley. And I asked her, I said, well, you know, we're talking about the airspace integration thing and what she thought if that was a big thing or privacy or, and she said, nope, product liability. And I told her about my data collection thing and trying to come up with your own data. And she said, that's probably a good idea because we're already facing product liability lawsuits because we have nothing. So I asked that too. So even with the micro arc, they're like, oh, you know, it's going to be self-certification. I go, you think that's good or you think that's bad? And she says it's bad for the companies because the thing is, you know, and I've said this before too, if the regulator doesn't have any standards for you, so like you're a manufacturer and you go, well, you know, we built our product to the, you know, regulator's standards here and, you know, so there was a failure, so there's a problem. So you can shoulder, the blame can be pushed off on the regulator a little bit. Now, nobody's going to go after the FAA because it's too hard. But you could say we did everything we could. Our due diligence, we did everything we could. If you self-certify, and I've told people this that, you know, are on the arc, but they know better than everyone else. It's amazing. So if I'm self-certifying and there's an issue where I hit somebody and there's a product liability, I have to shoulder all the responsibility. So I think as that goes on, you're going to see more and more lawsuits. You're going to see people as they proliferate. And then I think you're going to see if you have the big internet companies doing it. I've said this is, you know, you hit somebody with a drone from a big internet company, like, and we won't mention any names, Facebook. Their descendants will probably still be disabled.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let me ask you this question. Okay. We've been talking a little bit about the industry, some of the issues that may happen, you know, whether the industry will grow or not. The fact that there are more lawsuits coming down, self-certifying. One of the things that we've talked about is the whole portal for the waiver process and the issues it's caused, but more so the issue of the reaction from the industry as a whole. And you and I both know there are more drones registered than there are registered aircraft, and yet only 15,000 of those people are registered for commercial use, which I find that really hard to believe that only 15,000 out of 600,000 or 500,000 are using them commercially. And with people hearing the issues on the portal and the waiver for airspace, do you think that A, this will change, or do you think that more and more people are just going to ignore what the FAA says because they have no way to enforce it?
Well, you know, that's a There's a lot of stuff there. Oh, yeah. But let's talk about first the numbers. And I kind of alluded to that during the DAC thing. You know, the FAA came out, and this goes back to all these, you know, nonsensical forecasts. 80-some-odd billion, 127, 400 billion, you know. I mean, everybody was buying their own stuff, and then they get, you know, then you see these, oh, okay, well, we went to the industry group, and they said it was 89 billion, so that means there's going to be 7 million drones, yada, 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 okay? Say there were 4 million drones sold in the last 2 years, okay? Okay, we got 4 million drones, and that doesn't even consider all the RC people that are buying aircraft and planes and, you know, there's probably another 400,000 people. I mean, you know, the numbers are keep going, right? Okay, so you got 600,000 people are registered. Like you were saying, there's 16,000 people that have licenses.
Let me interrupt you for just a second. If I take DJI's sales numbers from December and then multiply them by 12, and let's say that even they don't get half of what they got in December, so even if I take half of that for an average, we are still 500,000 drones above the current number that's registered.
And you don't have to be a you know, economist or, you know, a scientist of any kind of to figure out that you have a compliance issue.
Yeah.
You have a serious compliance issue.
Oh yeah.
If somebody, my boss called me in and they said, hey, you know, you've been working all this and you spent all this money and you have budgets, which is another, you know, they do have a budget, and the UAISO is supposed to report back to the Associate Administrator of Aviation Safety every year. I've FOIA'd those budgets and the reports, you know, what you did, the blah, blah, blah. Probably 4 years ago, I finally got some stuff, but it wasn't what I wanted. Anyway, if you're going to spend all this money and all this time and you have this kind of compliance issue, there you got some issues. And that's why I think you're going to see a lot of people leaving the FAA.
That's already happening, right? Didn't someone just step down? And, you know, you made a good point on a phone call that we had a couple weeks ago when I was in Boulder, and you said, you know, let's look at what Huerta said at CES, and, oh, we're going to have this new regulation and this new regulation and this, and look what we've done. It's amazing. And it's like, you know, he said a couple things that, and I forget exactly what it was, that made you think, well, why would someone say that if they want to continue their term? That sounds like someone who's talking, who's about ready to jump off the ship and say, screw this.
Well, you know, I think the thing that you have to realize here, and you know, a lot of people off ramp from the public sector to the private sector, whatever. I wasn't buying that the over people thing was coming out for the new administration. Maybe if Hillary made it, possibly things might have been a little bit different. But I still don't think that. I mean, you're giving away a plum, one. The flying around people or over people or whatever, you know, and if someone was going to off ramp to the public sector or private sector, you know, that you're giving away something you could be consulting on for years. And I'm not saying that's the end game, but, you know, it is a distinct possibility that people are thinking about after they leave. This beyond visual line of sight thing, unless the FAA does a total 180 and just throws, you know, this history of aviation thing right out the window for as far as like the detect and avoid is concerned, or command and control is concerned, or certification is concerned, you know, yeah, we'll have something in 12 to 24 months. But if it is going to be like aviation-y, you know, then I think it's going to be years and years and years. All of this stuff has to be certified. I mean, you know, you're going to have pushback from the other stakeholders. And the other stakeholders in the room, and I will say that I did sidebar with some of the old guard at DAC, and they're just laugh. I mean, I don't even let the cat out of the bag, but I have these job offers for consulting. Yeah, you know, we're thinking we're going to get a standard for C2 with our technology in 6 months. You're dreaming. I don't even know who these people are talking to, you know. And maybe, again, the negativity might get me, you know, to tell people the truth. You know, how it really works, what you do is you get the contract for $250,000, and then at the end of 6 months you go, well, you know, we gave it the old college try, and I need another $250,000. And my wife needs a contract, and she consults too. And my dog needs something. And I mean, that's how this deal works. I don't make up this stuff. It's just the way it rolls.
The way the cookie crumbles, man. It's funny. There's just so much going on, and yet none of it seems to be in the right direction. But going back to that question, going back to the numbers, you know, we were talking about the numbers, that there's definitely a compliance issue. My question to you is, do you think that'll become more known this year? And do you think that there is going to be some sort of culture shift? Because what we're seeing is less and less people, I mean, like, a lot of people just get the 107 to be like, hey, I got the 107, I got it, we're good, you know? And like, how many people, you know, really fly according to the rules? Because even the FAA came on this show and said, we don't have the wherewithal to enforce these actions.
Yeah, but, you know, and you know, we had this conversation, too, on one of the hangouts that we do. And, you know, I was like, well, you know, the FAA, we had no idea. That's not true. You know, how come it's not? I know it's not true because I was there telling them, you know, and I told them that they would have compliance issues. And this goes back, you know, this goes back to like 2005, you know. So I've said, you know, like you can, even in the ARC, I was like, you can have all the regulation you want, man. You can have, you know, you got to have a bell on the thing and a whistle on it and whatever you want. But enforcement is the third leg of the chair. And if you don't have an enforcement program for off-airport operations, you got nothing. And, you know, you got a lot of this in the room.
Well, I mean, the perfect example, let's look at Casey Neistat, right? Broke every law that Skypan, quote-unquote, broke. And yet, here he is now working for CNN that has an exemption for flying over people.
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of the companies talk about safety out of one side of their face, and then the other side of the face, they're just pushing product. They don't care. Then you also have, you know, let's say, usually I find people don't like to go after anyone who can defend themselves. And Casey's got a huge following on YouTube. Yep. That includes people that are willing and freely dole out the death threats. You know, if you say anything about Casey negative, they will, you know, threaten your life. Okay? Or even ask questions. So I don't think anyone's going after him, even though there's videos of him going nuts, doing whatever. Maybe they will. I don't know. I will say that the FAA is doing enforcement and people are getting busted for not being in compliance with registration or whatever else. They're just a lot quieter about it now because I think what they're trying to do is get some wins and then they'll talk about it later because there's still some shaky ground. One of the things, too, is I talk to people all the time about the law and how they were supposed to do it and follow their policy. And I'll be the first to say that I don't believe like with the policy clarification in 2007. I mean, I did a call with, you know, all of the FAA legal counsel and the congressional liaison. I got a hookup through my congressperson's office. And I asked him, and I FOIA'd this too, I never got it, how they came to the policy clarification. Did they follow their administrative procedures manual? Did they follow the law? Well, it turns out they didn't have an administrative procedures manual. They just used, you know, some of Title V or the U.S. code and some others. And I go, that all sounds good. I'm slow. I'm a slow learner. Maybe you could send me, you know, how that all the interoffice memos and how that all came to be. I never got it. The congressional liaison said, we'll get back to you. We're going to work on this. It never happened.
So, Pat, we've talked about the compliance issues, the numbers. The FAA is trying to build up the wind to say, hey, we can enforce just like they did, you know, a year ago even and a year before that. But all in all, what do you think is the reaction? What do you think people should do? I mean, what do you foresee with all of these issues from the FAA and the drone users as a whole? Where does this road end this year?
Well, it's hard to say if it's going to where the road's going to end this year. I will say that it's going to be more put up or shut up. I will say, you know, look, people have to really kind of look at this whole thing objectively. I mean, you know, we've seen some of these companies that are supposedly just killing it. They're replacing their CEOs, you know. Okay, so you've got, you know, you've got a great season. The coach is in there. The team's winning. You fire the coach. I don't buy that. That doesn't sound good to me. And I've noticed in the social media thing, I do a lot of Twitter. And when you call these companies on them and they jump up like a big dog, you know, that's, I think, you know, there's an old saying about a hit dog howls. So I don't know what's going on there, but, and you're seeing a lot of pivoting too, where people are pivoting and partnering. You know, another, if your company is killing it and you're raking in the money and you don't know what to do with yourself because it's just, you know, streets are paved with gold, why would you partner with a company that has no customers?
Yeah.
Doesn't make any sense. The other thing, the VC people, they're crazy. You know, go back to the numbers again. You got 16,000 certificated pilots. Before you go and throw $10 million at a company or $20 million or $40 million, you know, run the numbers, man. You know, I don't think you're going to get your money back. But, I mean, you know, maybe I'm wrong. I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm an idiot.
Well, I think that a lot of the mapping companies, too, are seeing very little subscribers. They're, you know, the mapping isn't really taking off. And do you think that there is going to be a need in a technological leap forward so we can get better data so that we can actually sell these services?
Absolutely. And, you know, that's another thing is it seems like everybody's, you know, this disruption thing, and it's not something that's, let's say, new or only happens in the drone industry. This is a Silicon Valley thing. Everyone runs out there, and this whole disruptive thing really translates into we're not following the rules, just doing whatever. Now, all over the country and all over the world, people that are mapping with drones are getting cease and desist letters from the government. Can't call yourself a map maker or a, you know, survey.
That was in California, right, that you're talking about specifically?
California, Alaska, South. It's happening all around the country. People are getting these letters, cease and desist. You can't call yourself that. I mean, most of these are like there's a state board. You go take a test. You get a stamp. When you're a surveyor, you know, and we've talked about this. I've talked about the regulatory grade data. When you're a surveyor, you stamp your survey and you write in there what the accuracy is with a plus or minus centimeters.
What's the margin of error, right?
Yeah, and some of these companies have like, oh, you know, we've gotten it down from feet to inches. You're still too far out. So now if I go to court and I say, you know, my neighbor put up a fence on my property, and the judge says, well, what's your evidence? Your Honor, right here on my cell phone app, my neighbor is on my property. You know, he's going to be all like, oh, look at that. I'm even getting a phone call. He's going to be like, what? You know, get out of here.
So the way that I understand it is that people, and except for specific states, because after we talked about this, I looked up the California law, and you're right on par. But the way that I understand it is that you can create maps, but you can't ever sign off on them. You can't ever interpret the data. And I know in Colorado, what we found out from the surveyor's office was that, you know, you can make maps, but you can never, ever, ever use the maps for territory lines, property lines, exactly what you're saying.
Legal, you know, and I have the three types of data. There's the artistic grade, where you're out there and you're taking pretty pictures. Then there's commercial grade, where you're trying to sell things, and that includes TV, movies, houses, you know, cars, whatever. And then there's the regulatory grade data. And the regulatory grade data is where the money's at. And that's more of a scientific, repeatable process, mm-hmm. something to stand up in a court of law. I talk to these Fortune 500s all the time. Oh, we're afraid somebody's doing a survey. Oh, blah, blah, blah. You know, is it something that would satisfy the regulator for, let's say, a lawsuit or, you know, regulatory action?
Oh.
No. Oh, it's garbage. It's $1,000 garbage. So you can make all the maps you want, you know? I mean, you know, why would I even want to make a map if I can't do anything? Why would I pay for it? It just doesn't make any sense to me.
That's the point I was trying to get at, though, is that the regulatory grade data. I mean, even if you are creating maps and giving it to an architecture firm where they can sign off on it and they just don't know how to map really well, my point was is that the way that I understand regulatory grade data, with the drones that we have now, we're just not there yet. You know, the Phantom 4 Pro and the Inspire 2, you know, we're kind of scratching at the surface on regulatory grade data, but we're just not there yet. And that's why I asked you the question. you know, do you see that we need to make significant technological advances this year in order to get to that growth point of regulatory data so that these big Fortune 500 companies say, all right, it's time to use drones, and then the industry actually grows?
You know, let me just ask you a question, you know. I mean, and there's several things I'm doing about it. I'm a partner in a independent and private research center in San Francisco, the SF Drone School and Research Center. I just gave a plug. We're going to start validating manufacturer claims, you know, and use a scientific method. We're going to start there. We don't have any of the crash test dummies with the sensors yet, but we'll get there. Anyway, you can make maps for a construction company, but let's just say that you don't get the property lines right. And they do a big, you know, shopping strip mall tilt up thing. And, oh, you know, some of these codes, man, if you're off by half an inch, you may have to tear the wall down, you know, or get some kind of easement or some other, maybe buy some more property or whatever else. So, you know, if you're going to go into this construction project, you got millions of dollars at stake and your data is wrong. Nobody's going to pay for it. I mean, they're going to sue the pants off you. That's another thing with a lot of these industries. I keep talking about it. You're going to need, you know, I'm going to go do construction site surveys. Well, let me give you a little heads up, because that's how I got started in this deal. And before you even get on the site, you know, where's your commercial liability for your vehicle? Where's your workman's comp? Where's your liability for flying the plane? You know, so just getting on to the site has cost me about $4,500 in insurance. Then you might want to get errors and omissions insurance, you know. I mean, there's all of these things. So that way, if you do make a mistake and they got to rip the wall down on it and they got to redo it, you know, your insurance might cover it. But your insurance is probably going to come back and go, are you a licensed surveyor? Are you an engineer? Oh, no, I'm just a chucklehead with a $1,000 drone. Probably not going to cover that. And then the sheriff is probably going to be like knocking on the door and taking your house. There's a little bit more to business than a $1,000 drone.
Yeah, no, and it's a good point. So, good point. All in all, Pat, you talked a lot about what's going on in the industry. If you were to conclude with what's going on with the DAC, good, the bad, what we can do to change it, you know, what's going on in the industry as a whole, maybe what drone pilot small business owners can do to help mitigate any risks or any liabilities this year?
Well, there's, you know, that's kind of another, all these questions are pretty complicated. One, you have a huge vacuum. So there is no, like I said, commercial group of representing the end users, which is just unheard of. There's no, I mean, you know, dentists have people, podiatrists have groups. All of these users have groups that are actually advocating for the whole segment. Not happening here. So it's kind of hard to work as the, let's say, independent guy. Those are the guys that get picked on, guys and gals. You know, you can write your congresspeople or whatever, but you're going to get a letter back that says, oh, they've got this DAC going, which you have no representation at. So you're just, you know, you're out in the cold. Serious people that want to do this as a business, I keep talking about this. 2012, these were classified as aircraft. That was a big mistake, but whatever, we're there. Really, you want to do this? You might want to start emulating a Part 135 business, which is a commercial aviation business. Record keeping, maintenance, logs, all the rest of that, so you can kind of back up what you're doing. You're going to need insurance. Whatever niche you choose, this is another thing I tell people, because they say, well, I'm going to do ag, and I'm going to do construction, I'm going to do open pit mining. And I ask people, I said, do you know anything about these fields? Well, no. Okay, well, if you go out there and you think you're going to compete against some guy that's been doing open pit mines for 20 years and he knows all of the nuances and, you know, ins and outs of mining, and you're going to compete against him, you're dreaming. Same in construction. You know, I'm going to do roof inspections. Are you a, you know, licensed contractor or certified home inspector? No, I'm not. Okay, well, you're going to have a hard time competing against somebody who is, and who is fully licensed or insured or whatever else. The guy's going to have that leg up on you. So that's, don't compete outside of things you don't know. It's the same with ag. You know, people go out, I'm going to be the farm drones guy. Well, do you know anything about agriculture? Well, no. Okay, well, that guy's going to think you're, you know, you go out and talk to some farmer who's been farming for 30 years, and you're going to come out and tell him, you know, how to run his farm. And, you know, there's so many the stories that I hear about from people that go and talk to ag people, and the ag people feel like they're being spoken down to. That's not a good way to start a new business relationship.
No, it's not.
So, you know, you can do that, do that, get into it and just embrace that it's aviation and that's the way forward. I don't know. I think it's going to be hard to make money. And I've always said that the more regulation and things that you put on it kind of erode the value of the drone. And as we move forward, the FAA is going to have to come up with a new program. I came up with an exemption in the ARC, an under 4-pound exemption. I actually wrote language for it to be in the 2012 reauthorization bill. It was not supported by, the aforementioned, advocacy group. They wouldn't support it, so it didn't get put into that. But imagine if we had an under 4-pound exemption that was, let's say, based on standards from a community-based organization where you didn't need a license. You could fly to 400 feet. You could fly to 1,500 feet laterally. You can have the registration if you want to as a backup or whatever. I think it'd be a lot easier. A lot of the people that I think that are doing this are kind of weekend warriors. Be easier for them. So I don't know. I think we're going to have to see some changes to 107. I also think a practical test is coming down the road. I just can't believe that you can fly a 55-pound aircraft
without a practical test. Yeah, no, I agree with you. I think it's something that I would like to see. I'm sure a lot of the new drone guys would hate that. They'd be like, oh, it's a barrier to entry. But, when I heard some of the FPV racers say that $150 was too much money to take an aviation test, I was like, you should not even be able to touch a controller, ever. Because the fact of the matter is, whether you want to admit it or not, is you could hurt somebody. And all they want to do is say, hey, look, we just want to make sure that you're familiar with the rules. And it's going to cost us $150 because we have to run this system. And if you can't afford $150, what in the world are you doing flying something?
Right. Well, this goes back to the argument that we've had for a long time, is there's most people don't recognize the drone as an aircraft. It's treated like it's a cell phone or a toy or whatever else. But that's just not, that ship has sailed. These are aircraft. And, that was another thing. Remember, when they'll ever, I got to regulate the hobby. Part 101, you got regulated. Have a nice day.
Yep.
So those are some of the issues. When people say, well, what could we do to really turn it back and do something? Act of Congress.
Really?
That's where we're at now. Like I said.
Well, okay, so let me ask you this. You say an act of Congress, but look, John Taylor case against drone registration, part 48. Are we ever going to see anything with that? I had John Rupert on here, but it was the same old answer over and over again. I was like, come on the show when you have something to tell us.
Well, here's the big problem with, I've over the years, I've talked to, many attorneys. Well, I'm going to go in there, and some of them different degrees of cockiness. I'm going in there and I'm going to kick the FAA's butt or clean their clocker. And I'm like, oh, really? A lot of people. One thing I'll say about John, at least he's got an aviation background. Okay.
He's a nice guy too.
Big mistakes have been made because they don't understand the nuances of this. It'd be like me hiring someone who does contract law to defend me against a criminal case. I wouldn't do that because that'd be crazy. I'd be going to prison. So there's different types of law, things like that. Now, the other problem that you have is, my father had done a lot of consulting work for people that were suing the feds. They do not make it easy. You wither on the vine.
Shocker.
It takes 10 years, millions of dollars. So even, that he's not suing the feds directly, we're in a circuit district court, blah, blah, blah. I mean, it's all smart and really the way to do it on the cheap. But the thing is they just drag this out until you wither on the vine and die. That's just the MO. And so I don't see, if you're going to do it on a low budget, it takes forever. So that's another thing. The OEMs, even some of the ones that I have discussed before, did not put up enough money to really try and let's say mitigate some of the issues that are at hand here. And now all that cheap money has been spent, I did beat them up over there at the company here, the United States company, and said, you know, you spent all this money having people fly to exotic locations and take selfies with the drones, and you didn't spend any money on science.
Yeah.
Was that? I mean, you're gonna get the pictures for free on Instagram.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. So, do you think that with all of the difficulty in regulatory issues, the difficulty in lobbying, the fact that the small users are not being represented, yet that's the majority of people using drones, do you think all of that could culminate into a very good reason for companies like DJI to try to come out with better sensors, to get regulatory data, to get the Fortune 500 guys on their side, to then have that Fortune 500 money pushing Congress, the government, and lobbying to give us what we want in the drone industry?
Well, I mean, I think that's kind of what's been going on now. You have these big names go in there and everybody treats them like they're like the Messiah because they have more money than God. But I mean, for most people, I would say embrace 107. Use any experience in any field that you know that the drone would apply to, you know, and go out there and try and make a go out of it. Get insurance, whatever else. Just try right there. Forget about beyond visual line of sight. Forget about competing, you know, for the pipeline surveys and the high tension power line surveys, the LIDAR. I mean, everybody goes, oh, I'm going to go be LIDAR. You know, the $100,000 LIDAR sensor is a lot better than the $5,000 LIDAR sensor. Just saying. So again, what are your customers paying for? You know, in the map making and surveying, you know, if even these companies, you know, they're like, well, if I got to come out here and shoot the points, what's the point of having the drone guy come out here? Exactly. You buy your own drone, you get the license. I mean, look, forever, it didn't take me long to figure out the promise of drones was, you know, low altitude remote sensing, okay, whatever that's going to be, you know, whatever sensor you're going to have on there, self-guided data collection. That was really the key. So, like, if I'm, you know, a surveyor or whatever, I go out, I don't have to third-party Vulcan mind meld somebody who's going to be flying the 172 to get the aerial photography. I'll go get it myself. I go back to the car, check it on the laptop. Hey, I didn't get what I needed. I'm going to go back out there. I don't have to wait. I don't have to do anything. Those are really the benefits of the drone. And so that's how you really have to look at the business model. And, you know, all this time, we're doing things that we've never done. This is a first. A lot of it's already been done, and a lot of it could be done by airplane. So if the cost goes up, the regulations go up, and it's harder and harder to do, then you're going to be competing again with manned aviation, and you're not going to be working. So that's what would be my advice. Concentrate on those things that you think you can make a little bit of money of. Don't worry so much about the pot of gold out there, because the other thing is, since the beginning, the legacy vendors and DOD guys have been working on certification of their aircraft, type certification, and you're going to see aircraft drones that have type certifications. Those will be the aircraft that will be able to fly over people, fly at night, fly beyond visual line of sight before the, let's say, hobby-grade drones are able to do that. Mm-hmm. The other piece of advice I would leave people is, you know, I see people, I talk to them, and they're carrying the $100,000 sensor on the $3 motor. That's not going to work. You know, that's not a business model that's going to work. So, you know, think about these things. Just be practical. Take a step back. Take a big holistic view of the whole industry. Don't buy the hype. You know, it's like any other business. You know, if you're going to go buy a lawnmower or a riding mower and you're going to go into the landscaping business, you know, how are you going to build the better mousetrap? You know, you will have competition. That's the other thing. You know, when I first started doing this, I didn't have any competition. I want $2,000. Okay. You know, all right. Sounds great. You know, and then the competition started to come in, and a guy was like, I'll do it for $45. It's like, dude, you're giving it away.
Yeah.
How do you pay for your insurance? I don't have insurance. I don't need insurance.
Yeah.
It's crazy. So yeah. Those are the things to think about. There, you will have competition, and you got to think about how you're going to attract and keep your customers.
No, I think that's a great advice. I think it's great advice that you've also talked about people finding their niche and really focusing on what's going to make them money. I love that. And so one thing I want to get out there, just because I'm actually waiting for Rob to send you the advertising stuff that you sent to us, but one of the things I want you to get out there is that you have one of the best conferences, in my opinion, in the country when it comes to drones. When is that coming up? Where can people find out more information about you so that if they wanted to get this really deep, you know, deep dive type of industry influence and information, where would they go?
Well, they would go to www.susbexpo.com, and it's the Small Unmanned Systems Business Expo. The whole ethos of the show, this will be our fifth one. This was the first commercial show in the United States, not in the world, but in the United States. And basically, you know, the whole ethos is learn how to earn. We have high level. It's funny, I get people, oh, well, you know, I'll send somebody from the office. I talk to the FAA. We'll have someone from the office. I don't even want them. I mean, I invited Peggy Gilligan. You know, I want people that know what they're talking about to come and talk about drones. If they don't know what they're talking about, you can go to the hobby drone show or the selfie drone show. Another thing we're going to do is we're going to be doing this in San Francisco, and we're going to have a live flying demo day.
I saw that on here, the field day.
Yeah, the field day. And we're going to go out and you're going to see these systems in action. You know, there's restrictions apply, but it won't be, you know, I'm calling it free range drones. And you'll be able to see them. I'm tired of seeing them in a cage. I'm tired. That just doesn't even make sense to me anymore. So we're going to do that. The other thing we're doing a SAR workshop. We usually do a SAR workshop, but we're going to do a SAR workshop with a demo.
Awesome.
So you're gonna hear from Gene Robinson and John Buell. You're gonna hear about how they would set up to do a search and how it all works out. Then you're gonna go out into the field and they're gonna set up and actually fly the grid. You know, they're gonna do it. That is something that's totally different. So you know, those are the types of things we do there. The other thing is if you look at some of the speakers we have up there, I don't put all those speakers up there because as soon as our speakers go up there, they usually get poached. Which is okay. I want to share.
Meaning they get poached by other conferences?
Yeah, well, you know, you may have noticed last year, I don't even know how many, there were like, you know, three conferences a month going. It was, you know, out of control. It was, you know, we're having the dog grooming and drone expo. it was out of control. This year, I noticed that a lot of them have kind of died down.
Just to clarify, was that dog grooming with your drone?
Hey, you know, you could. I tried to invent a drone that, you know, you could brush your teeth with.
That was a CES joke, right?
But, you know, a lot of these shows have gone by the wayside because they just couldn't be supported. I mean, there was one here in the Bay Area where they had like this VIP thing where you paid, you know, $2,000 to go mountain biking with. I'm like, I don't have time to go mountain biking with people. I'm trying to run a business. So if I'm going to go to something, it's got to be worthwhile. Last year we had a guy, my favorite last year was this guy, Ray Hine from USDA. He's been using drones for about 20 years. And a guy just came and he talked about the shortcomings, what they could do, what they can't do. It just blew me away. Smoked me, you know. So if a guy could come in and do that and where I'm like, you know, then you know you're getting good stuff. And that's the whole point of it. So if you come out, and it's reasonable too. We're trying to get $250. It's a 3-day thing, including the field day. You'll meet some good people. You'll get to sidebar with people, the networking, very high level folks that are there.
Awesome. Well, we're planning on being there this year, and hopefully that we can become a good part of it. But for those of you listening, if you are running a business, you've got to check out his expo. Like I said in the podcast a few weeks ago, when we were talking about conferences, this is the conference I was mentioning at the very end, where I stated, you know, if you really want the business information, the insights, you got to go here. So, Pat, thank you so much for coming on the show. Really do appreciate it. And guys, if you want to find out more from Pat or stay in the loop with him, you can go to suasnews.com. But again, sir, thank you very much for coming on the show.
Hey, thanks for having me, and we'll talk again soon.
Sounds good, guys. That's going to do it for us today, guys. Look forward to seeing you again. Remember, if you have a question, go to askdroneu.com and upload that question. But that's going to do it for us today, guys. My name is Paul, and you're listening to Ask Drone You.